services on Easter Day at 9 and 11, the good times have begun. Getting into the swing of Holy Week by slowing down a bit. That's how we do it. Here is a poem written by Peter Cook that I've read a few hundred times in this church. He wrote it after having gotten some speeding tickets on his way from this island to Greenville. And getting there is the name of it. I'm going to read it just in the interest of slowing down. I had to slow down. I had to sprout some new veins and arteries through Carter, Jones, and Pitt counties. Find roads and places with names like Fox Meadow Forks, Doc Loftins, Pete's Reach, Buzzard's Corner, Pine Grove Chapel. And I did, too, often seeing a deer, a black bear once. And yesterday over a field of February milo, a northern harrier plunged behind a tobacco barn with a ball that shone. And the preacher is truly outstanding, to be Ronald Smith, and I look forward to it. Welcome.
Thank you.
mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully. In remembrance of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who in these holy mysteries gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 116 with the congregation responding after the asterisk. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication.
Because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I call upon him.
How shall I repay the Lord?
For all the good things he has done for us.
O Lord, I am your servant.
I am your servant and the child of your family. You have freed me.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving
and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord
in the presence of all his people,
in the courts of the Lord's house,
in the midst of the kingdom of Jerusalem. Hallelujah.
The second reading is from the book of Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer right then with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who is bathed does not need to wash except the feet, but is entirely clean. He washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table. He said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is who I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Verily, truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you're blessed if you do." Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man, little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, and now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated, as we like to call it. And still make it a church or choir practice on time. Terry and I are living temporarily in an apartment on the mainland while we were waiting and waiting and waiting for our new house to be built. And, you know, I've been known to complain a time or two about how long it takes to get here, how slowly the traffic moves, why they had to lower the speed limit on 58. But, of course, I know it's an easy, comfortable journey, and I have no reason to complain about it, but I probably will. But I wonder, you know, what travel was like for them. I wonder how much harder travel was for Jesus and for the disciples. I wonder what it was like to walk down those hot, sandy pathways in bare feet. It was slow and hot for them. So this custom of foot washing was an act of gracious hospitality in this culture. And it was performed, of course, by the host's most menial servants, sometimes by the wife, but never, ever by the host himself. And yet, here we have Jesus tying a towel around himself and washing his disciples' feet. The master, the teacher, the Messiah, performing this menial act that would normally be associated with the lowest servant in the household. Jesus even served to Judas, the one he knew was going to betray him, the one we would probably call his enemy. Yet Jesus kneels in this subservient way before his disciples. Imagine that the one he calls Lord could stoop to do something that a lowly servant should be doing. But Jesus persists. He tells Peter and the others that his call is to serve, and he will indeed wash their feet. And Jesus, always teaching, always modeling for his disciples and for us, Jesus wants to be sure that no one misses the point here. He says, I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet. You also ought to wash one another's feet, for I have set you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Radical Jesus, once again, bucking the social norms, doing the unexpected thing, tearing down barriers that people had established to separate. You must love one another. We can't say that Jesus wasn't clear here, can we? Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. Love those who are part of your family and those who aren't. Love those who are easy to love and those who are hard to love. Love those who mess things up and those who clean up the messes others leave behind. Love those who think like we do and those who don't. Love those who live in ways we cannot even fathom, and those who live what we would call exemplary lives. It is easy to say the others who haven't heard the good news yet, they'll know because they will see your love. They will be the recipients of your service. This is how they will know. It's a commandment that's so important that it's been celebrated since the earliest churches. In fact, the term mandi comes from a Latin word that means mandate or commandment. And this day in our church year commemorates this loving act of Jesus and the service that we are called to share. There are foot washing ceremonies and traditions in all kinds of Christian churches, including ours. And that's a good thing, because washing someone's feet is still an act that requires humility and a willingness to serve someone else. Imagery of the towel and the basin from this passage of Scripture and pledge to serve others in Christ's name. But all Christians, all who claim Christ are called to follow this command. Don't you imagine that later, after witnessing Jesus' death and resurrection, after setting out on so many more long, hot, dusty journeys the disciples would undertake, don't you imagine they would remember this experience every time they entered a home and had their feet washed by a servant? Don't you imagine they would remember the Lord kneeling before them with a basin and change their view of the world, change how they related to others, change their focus from themselves to the lowly people they would encounter? And could it be the same for us? In this new commandment, Jesus is inviting us to be the shareholders and the partners in God's work. We're surrounded by opportunities for Christian service beyond the walls of our churches. There's food to be bought, cooked and served and delivered, prayer shawls to be made, refugees to be welcomed, discouraged people to be lifted up, elders to be attended to, families to be supported, children to be cared for, money to be collected to help heal people and communities who are in crisis. Needy, hurting people all need to be washed. Many in need of the towel and the basin. As we come to the table tonight, I invite you to consider what this commandment
The Lord Jesus, after he had supped with his disciples and had washed their feet, said to them, "Do you know what I, your Lord and Master, have done to you? Peace which the world can give to you.
I give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you.
Peace is my last gift to you. My own peace I leave with you. Peace which the world cannot give, I give to you.
By this shall the world know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another."
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, guide the people of this land and of all nations in the world of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, grant us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy upon us, O servants of God, in your compassion.
Give you peace.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor of his name and the offerings that come into his courts.
Thank you.
Charlie McCurry's friend, BJ, who has been in this church many, many times, has a father, his name is Bill Satterwhite, who was 102 years old. And Bill fell last night and hurt his head badly, and is in the hospital. And it means a lot to BJ and to Charlie that I told them I want to make sure that you have opportunities to have prayer for Bill and for BJ and Charlie. So I hope you will do that during this Eucharist.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
To give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us the fullness of life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we
remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with St. Francis, St. Clair, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now sing.
living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food as a sacrament.
They have our garments among them. They cast.